What is going on, guys? It's Tubby Emu from Sports Gaming Universe alongside Not As Fan. Not As, yesterday the trailer dropped for MLB 18, and we talked about the jersey, so I want to pose a question to you, Not As. By the way, congratulations for being on your channel again. It's great to talk to you. How you doing today?
I'm doing great. I think you meant that trailer dropped today.
Okay, but they don't know when they're going to see this, but I have the big question for you.
Okay, if we're posting this tomorrow, we're doing something wrong.
Yeah, what... That's not, you don't know what we're talking about. That's the point. Because I wanted to ask you this, because you're big into this, right? Like the fans that watch this, maybe they have the same instinct. And I want to pose the question to them. What is so important to you? What? Because I've never got the whole jersey thing. I've never got why authentic patches, and you can bring up, you know, one of your biggest idols in the genre here. What makes it for a sports fan? Somebody that like has been following sports their whole life. What yeah. makes jerseys a thing to go after? Like what? Because I know you had you collected jerseys, you went after stuff, you had thoughts about why some jerseys sucked. I just love to know, because personally, I've never been a big like jersey hawk. I've never been a big patch hawk. I've never like looked at these trailers and went, I got this jersey. Do you know what I mean? Like I like to see what's in the like authentically, like say NBA, right? Like all the jerseys they have that are current. I love to see them in game. What about jerseys to you is like that step thing that makes them so collectible or sets them apart? What do you look for? Like why do you take it so seriously, bro?
Is this the 2-hour podcast version, or are we just keeping this real for like a 10-minute period? Because it depends on how I answer. I think most people are like you. I don't think most people get excited or as excited. I know most people don't get as excited as I do about jersey and uniform minutia. And here's where I'll just do my quick shout out to my favorite blog ever, UniWatch, from Paul Lucas, who gets published over there at ESPN.com a lot. When I found UniWatch, I was like, oh, there are other people out there that obsess about this stuff like me. That's pretty cool to know. It was validation right there. But yeah, I don't really know what it is. I mean, I guess it's for some people, including me, kind of that connection to a team. Being able to wear their jersey or their sweater. NHL and hockey jerseys in general have always been my favorite to collect and to obsess over. But
What drew you in originally? Was it the team? Like, what do you think brought you in, like, a sports fan? Like, that's what we want to do here at SG. We want to connect. We want to get out and talk to people. So, like, what drew you into collecting jerseys? What made it to you? What made it passionate for you, dude?
I don't remember exactly how old I was, but my first jersey I ever collected, received of my own, was a Montreal Canadiens sweater back in the day. And
interesting.
Just loved the, yeah, random, I know. But it kind of drew me into the whole, first of all, I idolized Patrick Waugh back in the day. Loved goaltenders, loved everything about him. I was fascinated, wanted to be one.
I did. I was fascinated by Patrick Waugh.
And that era, it was Patrick Waugh in Montreal.
See, I knew him here, from. I didn't know him from Montreal. I'm an Avalanche guy.
Come on, man.
I'm an Avalanche guy. So that's where we mix up a little bit. I don't even remember the Canadian.
Well, back then, they were the Quebec Nordiques. So
okay.
They didn't even exist at that point. But yeah, his cup run as a rookie and all that he did in Montreal. Like I flocked to games at Met Center when the North Stars would play the Canadians, so I could see Patrick Waugh. That was like a huge deal for me. I actually got to meet him and get his autograph when that was another obsession of mine. My early teenage years collecting autographs.
Oh, we'll talk about that. That'll be another video we're talking about.
Like we had here for the Super Bowl. Yeah, I spent many a New Year's Eve and nights like that out there when it was too damn cold to be out there, but I was out there.
Did you sit out there with the jerseys then? Like, I know you did autographs. Like, did you ever like try to get, like, did you ever, like, when you were younger collecting, did you ever like, was the game more and stuff, or the more authentic stuff, was that later in life, like when you kind of got like a financial footing with jobs and stuff, or like did you ever want that stuff signed? Do you think that brings down the value? Like, what are your thoughts on that?
There's very different schools of thoughts on that. My school of thought was that I never really liked any of the authentic or game used stuff as far as jerseys signed. I think it makes it kind of hard if you're looking to my main goal of getting a game worn jersey, and yes, that came later in life when I actually had some money to chase some of those things down. My Holy Grail jersey is, as people who collect, they all have a what they call a Holy Grail
or Grail jersey in mind. You know, the pinnacle of what they could collect. You know, and a lot of times that's personal. It's not just like I want a Wayne Gretzky because he's Wayne Gretzky. I mean, it's mine was personally a Russ Courtnall North Stars jersey because he was my favorite player. He didn't play here long, which made it kind of hard to track one down. And I actually had it, and I'm sad to say I no longer have it because times get hard and had to make some moves. But yeah, that was the one for me. And when I tracked it down, it was awesome just to know I had well, that jersey.
That's got to be like one of the hard things in life, right? It's like my grandpa is he collects firearms. And they love to trade, so like he likes to have a revolving stock. And you know, people that collect everything, you know, they keep it for a while. Some people keep it forever. Some people like to trade it. Some people, you know, they don't have any option, which it sucks when that happens. But it must have felt great. I mean, to be chasing your Holy Grail and to at least get it. Like to me, I don't know what like my Holy Grail would be. Like I think to me, the thing that would make me the happiest and to go like that's my childhood. I'd love to get a Sammy Sosa corked bat, like one of the.
Yeah,
man. I want one of those. Give me
a little steroid syringe to go with it.
No. Sammy Sosa didn't do any of that. What are you talking about? Sammy Sosa just beat. Sammy Sosa just had the cork bat, brother. That's what
baseball was very, very good to him.
Yeah, that's what I'm choosing to believe as a Sammy Sosa fan. Was there any time like when you were collecting these jerseys? Was the style? Because like I don't know, I've never been a big fan of hockey jerseys. Like I always wanted to play
hockey's the best to collect because like
they're big
what is
in
more
their...
colorful outside of I mean okay maybe soccer kits or something like that, but like what is more colorful and more show off than a hockey sweater?
Well, I don't mean necessarily colorful.
The,
I just
the
mean
traditions
like...
there in baseball, like okay, Yankees pinstripes, iconic, right? Like there's a lot of iconic uniforms in baseball, but I mean, man, they're bland. I mean, outside of like Houston's rainbow jerseys back in the day, or you know their retros, like something like along the lines of that. What is really, or like what the Diamondbacks are doing right now? I mean, like what is there that really stands out about a baseball jersey? You know,
I guess I never looked at it from the point of like what it looked like. I guess I kind of looked at it like to use a reference now, like the Kevin the Smith effect, wearing a hockey jersey, like you know what I mean, like that big bulky. Because they're bigger for the pads, obviously. Just like, I mean, because you can get a football jersey skin tight. I mean, obviously, you get hockey jerseys like that, too. You prefer, like, the bigger, bulkier. I don't know. It's just that whole style. I just never – hockey jerseys – I always wanted to play hockey. Maybe I'm just resenting the fact that I always wanted to play hockey. I grew up playing peewee up until the point where you had to start paying for it. And my mom went, nah, you can wait till high school when it's free.
Yeah, but you can't wait. That's what happened to me is like, you know, by the time I actually got interested in skating and, you know, playing pond hockey with friends, I was way behind everybody as far as organized hockey.
Because I was, you know, I was like
one
of the
focus on football and baseball. But yeah, definitely, you know, hockey's always been my favorite sport to watch in person. It's not a very good TV game, but in person, it's amazing.
So what do you look for jerseys then? Like when it comes to something like hockey, like to me, I know one of the big controversies, and I don't want to bring anything up, but like double stitched or like, you know, sewed on or all this other stuff. Like what do you look for? So if somebody like is watching this video and they have a passion too, they love to collect jerseys. What are you looking for? Like what really drives you to a jersey? Like what's... Is it the patches? Is it like the actual authentic? Like, do you like the styles? Is it the colors? What are you chasing?
For everybody? Like I'm not a person who can go to the mall and be like, oh, I like that iron on replica, you know, so dumbed down version of a jersey, you know, for I'd say, I mean, I don't know numbers, but let's just throw 75% of the population who's a fan of a team. That's probably good enough. You know, they're repping their team. That's something they can wear to games.
So you don't like the knockoff jerseys like they sell at Shoes and Sporting Goods where it's like it's not a jersey. It's not even like a jersey. It's kind of like a t-shirt jersey that like some people buy and they're like, I'm a Packer fan. And like, that's what you
wear. I'll
wear
that under my jersey.
Okay.
Like,
true.
So it doesn't get all sweaty.
Fair point.
But no, it's for me, it's authentic or nothing. Like I've gone through the different stages collecting authentic jerseys. I had a closet. I think at the highest count, I had about 350 at one time in a walk-in closet. That all got transferred. I have a pretty good eBay rating, let's just say, because of all the trading back and forth. Because here's the thing with collectors, and like there's an actual really cool board out there on the web for people who are collecting specifically game worn jerseys. It's called gameworn.net. And
is this like the Foo Fighter forums that you're
on? It's kind of like me hanging out on the Foo Fighter forums, yeah. But it's like you know, it's like I kind of pop in there. It's definitely not as much anymore because I've kind of, you know, strayed away from my collection for monetary reasons.
But well, it's not cheap. That's the thing.
I don't want to get the itch again because it'd be very expensive if I do. But it's a great tool there because people can kind of, first of all, like, you know, you think you track down a jersey, you got to do your homework if you're looking at the game worn stuff. Because you don't want to get taken for something that's not, you know, authentic. You want to kind of do your homework and, you know, do at least what you can to kind of get some references or whatever. So it's a good place to you know, people kind of list their good dealings with people that are trustworthy in the hobby. But then also just to kind of, you know, there's obviously like a basically like an ad section. This is what I'm looking for. This is what I might have.
Did you ever take your jerseys to get them like verified? Like obviously like, Russ Cornell was like your dream jersey. Like, did you ever, cause I think like collecting coins and cards, cause like my dad was big into card collecting. Right. So growing up, we had all the books with the values of the cards, every single thing about them. I used to go through my books. Like that's what he used to say. You'd pass down to me or like his collection of like those little racing cars. So like, do you get them like what minted graded? Like, is there such thing as graded like authentic jerseys, or is it just the jersey? Like, no matter the condition, is that like a thing? Does it
these days like the newer stuff? You know, like mid 2000s on, is not as hard because you know the teams do a good job of stamping their jerseys. They write letters of authenticity, those kind of things that should come with the jersey. There's even a company called Migre. That's out based in New Jersey, that they actually struck a deal with the NHL for, it's kind of on a team by team. I'm not exactly sure how many teams are in the program now, but they basically did a pre-authentication deal where there's a tag in the hem of the jersey. Everything is documented and whatever, and you can pre-order these jerseys while they're playing in them, kind of watch them get scuffed up. You can go to the games and actually watch them, you know, play in your jersey. Because they'll tell you what set they're wearing when and all that. And then when they switch to a different set, that thing gets shipped to you. It's a pretty cool program.
So that's what I wanted to – I'm glad you brought that up and touch on it then. Does that cheapen it in any way in your opinion? Because like if you think like back in the day when they would play, like now like you said with programs like this – they already have the jerseys like planned out to sell, right? Like it's like WWE. WWE does a great job of everything that happens in the ring, they know is a collectible. It's sold and it's tagged as collectibles. So back then, jerseys like, oh, if you were lucky to like, you watch the games like when, it wasn't Anthony Davis. I'm trying to figure out the basketball player that like took off the jersey off his back and threw it to the kid. And the kid about lost his mind. It was a basketball, I think it was a football game. And like that's kind of like a rare thing, right? So now that all these jerseys are kind of, does that to you weaken it down at all? As somebody that's been collecting for 30 years, like how you had to go through it?
I don't feel like that weakens it. I feel like that's kind of like, you know, you're making a big investment, and especially when one of these teams that's in the program happens to get like in the Stanley Cup Finals and they start pre-ordering these things and a lot of money's rolling around. I mean, you want to know that you're 100% verified and, you know, that this is authentic and stuff, and take some of the guesswork out of there. I mean, I think it's kind of a neat novelty to, you know, perhaps know that like that was your jersey being worn, and you could, you know, gather some pictures. So one of the biggest things you can do is get a photo or video match of the actual jersey for even more, you know, points of authentication. The thing that I think, the thing that just makes my skin crawl is the whole craze of the card companies buying up the authentic jerseys to cut them into pieces and put a square on the cards.
Yeah, I could see that.
That just drives me nuts. Like, you're taking a piece of history out of circulation to put it on a card that some, you know, kid's going to pull in a pack. And I don't know. I mean,
as a jersey snob,
I'm sure there'd be people that disagree with me and love to collect those things. But to me, that's just a travesty to have those things cut up for squares just to plaster on a card. All right. So that's what it feels like cheapens to me. Or if a team is pumping out, you know, just way too many sets just to get,
you mean different versions of the jerseys? You mean like,
because
NBA?
One of the things you want as a collector is you want a jersey with good wear on it. You know, like, you know, it's kind of counterintuitive to any, you know, collectible you might think. You're looking for mint condition in baseball cards or anything like that. To a jersey collector, I mean, you pretty much want that thing like tattered and torn.
You want the blood. You want the blood, sweat, and tears.
You want all the battle scars. You want the board burns. You want the puck marks. You want all the Frankenstein stitch-up jobs that the trainers have done.
What was your best
broken jersey? You don't get as much of that these days because they are pumping out more sets, but...
What was your best broken jersey? Did you have one that like was just tattered that had blood on it that you like show people like, yo, this was Patrick Waugh when he got sticked in the face from the goalie and like his blood is all over. Like, did you have anything like that that was like the big collectible? Like,
you know, teams are, you don't come across blood on there so much because like, you know, they have standards of, you know.
Come on, somebody had to take a punch from an enforcer somewhere.
Yeah, it's more repairs. That Cortinol was actually pretty good. It had a pretty good like long 2-3 inch stitching job done on it, repair job on it. I had a couple that had board burns that had burned straight through the ultrafill material.
That's what I was wondering.
By the way, they just don't make the jerseys like they used to.
Did they reuse them?
The ultrafill jerseys. Those were so great.
That was what I was trying to ask earlier.
Aeronet was okay, but the ultrafills were it at. Like that ended about the 91-92 season. They made the switch over on those teams.
Did they wear them back in the day? Did they wear them more than one? That's what I was trying to get at when I meant the importance. Like now every single jersey, like you said, is accounted for. Did they patch jerseys up and reuse them?
In that program, there's about four sets in a year. So, you know, they're worn about a quarter of the season. The only problem is you got teams that, well, not this year with the changeover to Adidas, they got rid of alternate jerseys for the 1 year because they couldn't keep up production. But, you know, you got home roads alternates and, you know, like usually three sets of jerseys a team or, you know, three different home, you know, home road alternate plus four sets of each. So that's where you're getting less wear. But, it was hard. It's hard though. Like you say, the hunt to like get a Grail jersey, especially if it's in an older era and, just to kind of track down the details. You asked if I ever got anything authenticated, like back from that day, like the North Stars were good back in the day of putting set tags on their jerseys. They weren't so good at like being consistent of when they were worn, because I actually did seek out a guy who I consider to be a North Stars expert. Because he's had so many dealings with the team and with the trainers, equipment managers, those kind of things, the players.
So Boof Bonzer.
I basically, you know, kind of ran it down like, okay, you know, you think this one's legit? What are we looking at here? And one of the problems was with that Cortinol that I got, I actually video matched it, grainy VHS tape, matched to the last game at Met Center ever. They lost to the Blackhawks that night, and then the next game they missed out on the playoffs. But Cortinol scored the last goal for the North Stars at Met Center. He goes back to the bench high-fiving. I see some of the marks on the jersey, but I'm like, I'm asking this guy because it makes no sense. It was a set two, and they had four sets. I'm like, how is he wearing a set two in the last game? And he's like, yep, North Stars did a lot of inconsistent stuff like that. It very well could have happened. So I'm like, okay, I got video match. I'm going with it.
See, that's like the one thing. I think I would just buy in, right? I think that's what, one thing that, like, when it comes to just believing in something, is like, you know what? I'm gonna choose to believe this. Like, to me, it wouldn't bring down the value. Like, if I found out, like, okay, no, that was a Russ Cortinol, but maybe it wasn't like that exact. Like, you know what I mean? Like, maybe it was a different one. Like that. To me, that wouldn't be a big thing. But like, as we've talked about all this, what advice can you give somebody that's listening to this? Maybe they're trying to get into collecting. What are the biggest pieces of advice that you can give to somebody maybe just starting out or somebody trying to get more into this?
I would say, okay, so I haven't even gotten into a lot of my idiosyncrasies, but like, you know, I for me, it's authentic jerseys. I also kind of get hung up on people kind of make it fun for themselves collecting, whether it's like just authentic jerseys.
Is the chase as fun as actually getting it? I mean, obviously not actually getting it.
Actually getting it is fun for a while. I think the chase might be more fun.
Gotcha.
As far as the game warns, because it's fun to kind of track that down and that feeling like, oh, I found it. It's coming and whatever. And then, you know, you're finally staring it down. I can't believe it's my closet. But like, I had a little bit of that where like I was collecting North Stars jerseys from a very specific era. It was the last 2 years they were here, 91-92, and then the final season 92-93. I got up to like a dozen jerseys from those two teams from the 2 years. And then I kind of got to the point where the Minnesota Wild came on the scene. They were purposely hanging onto their jerseys like the first couple seasons, nothing got out. They were all in their warehouse. Like, they just didn't exist.
They got a WWE warehouse. WWE does that. The whole warehouse has every single prop from history. Just in
exactly.
There.
It's like that. They're very tight about any of their equipment getting out, whatever. So I remember it was probably about the third season.
Maybe it was even further into that, but it was a well ways in.
And they finally decided, okay, we're going to open this up to at least season ticket holders. I knew a guy. He brought me on in. You know, they get disc, you know, pretty steep discount as season ticket holders and all that. And wasn't even really supposed to bring me in, but he got me in there and I got my hands on a jersey or two with, you know, pretty steep price. But I started selling off or trading off some of those North Star jerseys to do that. Probably, you know, in hindsight, I probably should have hung on to the North Star jerseys because they were, you know, at this point now much harder to come by. Now that the Wild have not, you know, have had all these seasons and they've opened up their collection a bit and it's not that new novelty. But I mean, I had a Mike Modano game worn Stars jersey.
I was going to say, that's back when I watched it.
Probably
hockey.
Was valued about $2,500.
Damn.
And at the time, because of the scarcity, it was roughly the same amount to get a hold of a Marion Gaborik Wild jersey. And so I basically did the flip on that. And yeah, like if you put both up to me right now, I'd take the Modano 10 out of 10 times.
See, like the one that I think that's back when I watched hockey, right? Because I was big into sports for the longest time, probably till about 2001 to 2 is when I kind of like faded out a little bit. But like I was a huge Blues fan. Like I loved, like if I had to pick out a hockey jersey, it'd probably be Chris Pronger.
Yeah, man.
There was something that Chris Pronger I fell in love with, especially in like in the hockey games, like the one timers. Like I just loved playing. They're like, yeah, Pavel. Like I was trying to think back to like their 2000 team. Like who was all on there? You had Pavel. You had Chris Pronger. You had Pierre Turgeon. I loved Pierre.
Was this pre or post Brett Hull in a Blues uniform?
I think that was post. Yeah, I'm pretty sure Brett Hull wasn't it when I was watching. Because it was the same time. Like the reason I got into watching the Blues more was because I was a Rams fan in 97 when they got drafted, when sure. Orlando Pace got drafted. So I started watching the Blues more often in like 98 to like 2000 is when
so
I started
So this was
watching.
Definitely post Curtis Joseph then. Cujo and Net.
See, Cujo, yeah. Well, see, I like Cujo. I play the games with Cujo. I think it was like 90.
See, that was back in my heyday autographs, you know, meeting Curtis Joseph and all those guys on those teams.
Yeah. So to me, that's like that. If I had to go after a jersey, if you had to go after one right now, like let's say money wasn't an issue, same thing with pose the question to your audience. If you could go after one jersey right now, if there's one jersey, any sport, anything, which one would you go after? Super Bowl, a World Series. An NHL final, golfing, like what would be right
golfing?
Now?
Yeah, I'd like Tiger Woods slacks, please.
I was just going to say that. You wanted Tiger Woods. Yeah, just give me one for the fans, and I'll pose the same question to them to
well,
kind of like send
because
them
because I'm so hockey-centric, it's got... Okay, I'm going to go this way. I think it's something that doesn't exist yet, but okay. it would be a Minnesota Wild Stanley Cup Finals jersey. At some point.
By which player? Which player would you want the most for a
well,
future jersey?
Probably by that time, it's probably going to be like Zach Parise's kid or something like that. Who knows when that's going to happen?
Okay, current. Let's say next year they were in the Stanley Cup. Out of all the players, like if you had the team right now and they made the Stanley Cup and they won, wait, who's the one player on that team? Or is it just any jersey? Because it's you. Is it just hard? Is it going back to is like you collected, right? Because you collected the ones from your era when you had the team. Because I know you were so disappointed when they moved away. So you kind of latched onto that. I think a lot of people do that.
Okay, so if we're going with something that exists, then it would have to be a North Stars Stanley Cup Finals sweater from the 91 Cup Finals when they lost to the Penguins.
Okay.
Probably like a, it would be a Basil McRae. I'm not even going to. I'd be Basil McRae.
I don't even know what that is.
I mean, I'm not going to turn down like a Neil Broughton or
you're just saying names at this point. I don't believe
Bobby Smith or anything like that or John Casey, but definitely Basil McRae, man.
All right. Anything you want to say like as a final thing, like any jersey collector?
I feel like there's so much I didn't cover because I kept going on tangents. Yeah. You asked me like what advice I'd have for people. What I was getting at is that everybody kind of like made it fun for themselves. Like made a certain, like I think I'm going to collect everybody who wore the number 36 or like, you know, like their favorite number. Like all of a sudden they got all this, the, you know, collection full of guys who wore 36, or I'm going to collect everybody from my hometown of, you know, wherever the heck they were from, or
gotcha.
I'm going to collect, you know, dude's name Paul or something. You know, like they kind of came up with some kind of fun angle to what they'd collect. And I always thought that was cool. So for me, you kind of touched on it. It was always jerseys with inaugural patches, all-star patches, anniversary patches, whatever it would be. I loved jerseys with special patches on them because that just was like one moment in time. So like the ones that I would just absolutely lose my mind were like that 91 Penguins team or 92. Like, you know, you had a year in time where the league was celebrating the 75th anniversary of the NHL. That's probably one of my favorite patches of all time, that 75th anniversary patch they had. It was also the 25th anniversary for teams like the North Stars, Penguins that came into the league in that wave of expansion. So like you had that. And so like if you find like a, you know, if you're doing authentic jerseys, having one with like, you know, Mario Lemieux, which would have like captain's patch, 75th anniversary patch, 25th anniversary patch, and then the Stanley Cup Finals, it's like, whoa, you know, all these special patches all at once.
Did you ever go after just the patches? Did they ever just have the patches? Like when it came to that,
yeah,
did you
get the, yeah, as a matter of fact, okay.
And would you ruin a jersey to put
even,
the patch
I hate
on?
To even speak this guy's name because he's like still to this day hated around here, but Norm Green, who bought the North Stars and moved him out of here. When he took over the team and that year that they had the 75th anniversary, I was trying my hardest because like back then it was like not a common thing. Like they didn't just pop them down in the team store. Like they'd try to, you know, get on that. Like these days, if there's an anniversary patch, it's probably being sold for 15, 20 bucks in the team store to, you know, make a buck, or all-star patches, whatever. They were harder to get a hold of back then. Just like it was harder to get.
Are they the same patches they sell in the
store?
Your
authentic jerseys lettered correctly and that kind of stuff.
Are they the same patches that they sell in the store, or did teams have a different one? Is it like a replica patch though? Is there any difference?
That's what happened. Like the first one I tracked down for 75th anniversary patch was like a smaller, like just like collector's version of it. It wasn't the actual jersey patch. That kind of frustrated me. But anyway, I wrote a handwritten letter to Norm Green asking if I could get my hands on one of these. And I think I got some kind of response from him, but it was like, I didn't get my patch. Let's just put it that way.
Dang. I was about to say, did you get a secretary letter, like signed photo? Like,
you know, it was something like that. It was like, it was the kind of like the, you know, the PR, like, hey, thanks for having an interest in the team, whatever, blah. But yeah, so I even went as far to try to do that. But yeah, that was one of the best parts is that those last two seasons that the North Stars were here, it was the 75th anniversary of the league, that 91-92 season. And then the next season, which ended up being their last, was the 100th anniversary of the Stanley Cup. So every team wore that patch as well. So it was a good 2 years as far as like, you know, what I'd like to collect with special commemorative stuff, and happened to also be the last 2 years of existence for the team. So I think that's why I kind of gravitated towards those. And when I actually got those game worns, it was pretty sweet. But when I would collect the authentics, I would often through eBay or wherever it was, I would track down the patches. And so I still to this day somewhere in a shoebox have a bunch of those loose patches, but they were always meant to put on a jersey at some point when I was able to get my hands on it.
Well, that was my last question, was would you put those patches on it? Did you feel like that would ruin the jerseys at all? So
I used to have a guy back in the day, like back before, you know, the internet was so prevalent. There was a guy in town here who was pretty good at doing these authentic jerseys because, okay, I'm that guy where like I've even had jerseys done by the Wild themselves. Okay. And they don't do them in house. They send them to a local sporting goods,
probably
sporting goods company that's down the street. Right. And so like, they're the ones that letter the actual players' jerseys. Now, I think since then they've kind of got like a heat press deal going on where they can do some at the stadium, you know, keep that away from me. But anyway, there used to be a big thing is like, okay, this is my level of snobbery when it comes to jerseys. Like they've done my jerseys. I paid them the full amount, you know, to get this, the whole, you know, authentic lettering done. I expect it to be done right. So, you know, I'd wait 3-4 weeks and come back and I get the notice to come to the team shop to pick it up. And here I've got, you know, a jersey authentic material, and they go put that really stiff tackle twill nameplate on it. Like, and oftentimes like the, it'd be like the standard plate that's, you know, can allow for like 12 letters on it, but they never snipped it down to like the edge of the names like they do on the real players. So you got wrong material, you know, lazily done. I'm like, nah, you're sending that back and you're giving me jersey material. I'm like, I didn't pay that much money to get it done that way.
That's a fair point. That's a, so yeah. would you tell that to people, like as a send off note, would you tell people if you're going to invest in the money, did it pay off for you? Did you get the payoff? Did they go ahead and fix it?
I mean, it was a headache and it costs extra time, but it's funny. Cause like, I'm usually like, I'm accommodating to a fault. Like usually pretty much anything in my life, I'm kind of like, oh, that's okay. That's good enough. I'll deal with that.
I can vouch for that.
I don't want to inconvenience people like to a fault. I don't stand up for what I want. When it came to jerseys, I'm like, no. And I got to the point where I knew they were going to screw it up. So I'm like, you need to write this down in the notes, jersey material nameplate, you know, like, I will not accept anything else, you know, trim it with the name. Don't leave all that excess on there. Cause like 99% of the people walking by me are never noticed that, but I know it. I know it's wrong. Like I get the same way when like somebody puts an anniversary patch on like a jersey, like, you know, we could go through the evolution of the official branding of the jerseys, but it used to be CCM for the longest time.
Yep.
Right. Well, then they kind of came in a thing where they're okay, CCM for home jerseys and Coho gets the road jerseys. And then we went to, you know, we've gone to Reebok, we've gone to Adidas now, we've gone to, you know, for a while there, it wasn't even fully regulated so the teams could choose. Like back when the Red Wings were winning all their Stanley Cups, they were wearing Nike jerseys. Same thing with Edmonton in the Gretzky years, like they had Nike jerseys. So it's like to see a jersey that's, I'm like, you know, or like an alternate jersey that didn't exist when they had that patch. Like those kind of things drive me nuts. It's like, it's my own little form of OCD, like for sure.
That's, you know, other people but have that.
That's why when I found UniWatch in that blog about how they broke it down and like, well, this team on Tuesdays wears this jersey with this matching color. And, you know, like, I'm like, oh my God, there's other people out there just like me.
And he
pay attention to this stuff.
He's got a big following. So your audience that's listening to this right now, there's, if you're listening and everything you're hearing from Nottis's mouth and you're like, wait, there's such a thing that exists. It does. You can go over to UniWatch.
I was so shocked when I stumbled upon it. I'm like, it's like I wrote this blog. I'm not even kidding. I'm like, I cannot believe that, you know, and I think he's got more of a, like more than just sports. I think he's got kind of like a, you know, clothing or apparel. Like there's some background that he has that interests him more than just the realm of sports, but like something tied him to that where he's so clued into all the little details, you know, like, and they'll go back and compare like, oh, that team, like they did that guy's name in the wrong font on the back of the jersey. Like, and this should be rounded off like this. I'm like, this is awesome. I could spend hours reading this stuff.
You absolutely could.
Such a nerd when it comes to that.
Look at you go. At least this is what I love to see, man. Passionate topics. So I want to pose the question to your audience now. Share your experiences, but you heard Nottis mark out, nerd out, and go crazy for jerseys. What's something about sports that you'd love his take from? Not like we're going to come back to this. We're going to let the fans let us know in the description what something, if they get to this point, what is something else that Nottis can really do a deep dive on? Because I think if you're a jersey collector, I think your audience is really going to like something like this. So I have some topics in mind for future video. I know we talked about cards a little bit. We'll be following up on things that happen, but I want to make sure you guys stay subscribed, stay notified, make sure you hit that bell button if you guys are following. You can go check out the Patreon goodness is in the link in the description. And Nottis, I appreciate you actually sitting down and talking to me. I really enjoyed this, actually listening to you, because it's fun to understand what makes people love sports and connect with sports. It's because sports is a very it could be a divisive thing. But when you get something like this, it's just great to connect with fans, man.
It's a very personal thing. Like, you know, whether it's collecting your favorite team's jersey or collecting autographs from those players, or, you know, just even, I mean, I suppose in this day, it's probably even a bigger thing to, you know, get a selfie with your favorite player or whatever it is. Or like that kid at the Super Bowl last night with Justin Timberlake, you know, getting that selfie.
That selfie. But, that's good.
You know, it's, we all have that personal level, you know, if you are a sports fan, I'm sure you have some kind of personal level of why you love the team you do, whether it's your hometown team or some player, like, you know, like you said, Chris Pronger attracted you to the Blues, you know, whatever it is, we all have emotional attachment some way with our favorite teams. And, you know, for me, a big part of it was jerseys and collecting that. And yeah, I don't know. It's just it's a level there for everyone in some way. So there's a lot of passionate people out there about what they love, whether it's sports or otherwise, and, you know, whether it be music. Oh, that's a whole other topic we can get with me. Very passionate about
you are you're one of the
music
most
and all the bands I follow and have seen over the years and all the venues that I've taken in shows. But
we're gonna follow up on that, because I think music's got a big thing at sports too, especially like when you're at the game. So I'm gonna save that one specifically. But let's, like, the last thing I want to touch on really quick is, like you said, that connection. I can't tell you why, as I grew up in Wisconsin. I couldn't tell you because I love the Badgers. I never liked the Packers. I never liked the Brewers. I never liked the who else is in Wisconsin? I can't even tell you. I never fell in love with those teams. Something about 97, watching the draft and hearing Orlando Pace, and I went, that's a cool name. So 2 years before they became the greatest show on turf, I loved them. And as a Rams fan, everybody was like, you live in Wisconsin, you got to cheer for the Packers, brother. And I'm like, no. I don't. And then I was already a fan 2 years ahead of time. I had the sweatshirts. I had, a jersey. And this was before. And heck, this is how bad it was. Notice, I want to touch on this. I was even wearing our biggest rival's high school jersey. I had the sweatshirt for Menominee. That's how big of I was a Menominee Indians fan, because I grew up with the coach. What was his name? I can't think of the big legend in Menominee, the coach that was there for like literally 15, 20 years.
I went to college there.
I know, I'm spacing on it, but I fell in love with them. So I've been on that side of history, man. I want to go back and see some of that stuff, but not as.
Well, that's just like me talking about my first jersey ever, Montreal Canadiens. You know, I love the sweater. You know, I love the tradition with it. It got me into both that and my love of, you know, just watching Patrick Roy play. It got me into loving the rivalry between the Bruins and Canadiens, and being an outsider, I could appreciate the rivalry from both sides and just appreciate what it was every time they go head to head, just like Yankees Red Sox. You know, just seeing that clash all the time, and, you know, that kind of tied me in. But you say, you know, you like all Wisconsin teams essentially besides the Packers. Well, you know, I became a diehard Red Sox fan from afar, kind of bought into all Boston teams except the Patriots for whatever reason. I just have never latched onto the Patriots. Maybe it's because, well, even back then,
you prefer losers.
Even when they were winning their first title, I wasn't really that on board. But it's like, especially since, you know, they've been so prolific. I tend to latch onto underdogs and teams who have never won before when it comes to Super Bowl situations and things like that. But
that's what I love fantasy sports.
Whatever it is, the Patriots, I just never really felt that, like, okay, there's my, you know, cheering for Boston from afar. Like, you know, the Red Sox are a diehard situation for me. I very much like the Bruins and Celtics. It's not on the level of Red Sox for me. And then you got the Patriots that are like the outlier. So it's just kind of odd for me. And like, why I ever latched onto the Michigan Wolverines. It's like, I went to Michigan football camp as a senior in high school. That was an awesome experience, but I liked them long before that. So, like, where that ever developed, I don't know.
That's the thing about sports, man. You don't know where it develops. I know where something does develop, though, which is on your Twitter, twitter.com/NotisFan. You can follow me, Toby Emu. We're going to be back with more of these Notis. I can't tell you. Like, I know we keep going on these wormholes because there's so much to talk about, but we need we need topics. So you can tweet him. Let me get a hashtag. Put it up, hashtag Notis Talk on Twitter. Tag us. If we see those tweets, we're gonna like them, comment them, retweet them. We're gonna try to get these topics for the video. So tweet us, hashtag Notis Talk, and I think SGU Talk would probably be better. SGU Notis Talk, whichever one you prefer. And we'll be back, because Notis, I think we're gonna end it right here, because I know we could keep going on forever and ever, because you're so passionate about sports, and that's what SGU is about. That's what SGU is going towards, and that's what we want to connect with, that diehard fan, whether it be jerseys, autographs, whatever. We all have that love for sports. So Notis, I appreciate you being brutally honest, open. I love the fact that you're letting it all out, brother. Finally, this is what I've wanted forever.
Well, this is the kind of stuff what we used to talk about. I mean, people who have stuck with the channel for years and may have been around for like kind of the marathon live streams, these are the kind of questions I love to answer. And we talked a lot about it. Some of the stuff would not be a surprise for people who've been around for a long time, but people who are newer to the channel, I'm sure, have not heard these stories. So it'd be very much fun to kind of rehash or tell them for the first time, depending on who's listening.
All right. Very good point. So until next time, guys, thank you very much for listening. I hope you enjoyed this. I hope you found it informative. Until next time, it's your boy Tubby Emu. Not a fan. I appreciate it. Have a great day, man. And let's get excited for MLB The Show 18 coming up.